Right. Well, thank you for the invitation. It's an absolute pleasure to give this talk. I haven't spoken about diffractive hearer data and so on for some time now. It's also a pity not to be giving this talk in Zakopane, but maybe sometime in the future. So I'm going to move on and talk about what are called diffractive interactions. What do I mean by diffraction? Well, you could argue that all afternoon, but bottom line is the sort of diagrams that are on this front page here. So cases in which in a deep inelastic scattering process where one of the protons stays intact. And in a sense, that can be quite surprising because protons can stay intact even when the momentum transfer squared q squared is very large. So sometimes you have a case where the protons actually hit very hard in the transverse direction and yet it stays intact. So that's the sort of thing that attracted me to study these things. There's a couple of diagrams which we'll come back to later in the talk on the sort of physics processes that are taking place, but I very much like the artist impression type things which Rolf also showed. So on the bottom there is the sort of structure that we're trying to reveal. Now, most of the existing physics results on diffractive lepton-hadron scattering come from HERA, so I'll talk about HERA for most of this talk, but then I'll say a few things about the link to EIC at the end. So I successfully predicted what Katarzyna was going to talk about. So I'm going to start, my starting point is going to be things that were in her talk. So this is inclusive data from HERA, H1 and Zeus, where one of the things that Katarzyna emphasized was low X physics. So let me start from that sort of viewpoint. So the Q squared dependence of F2 or close to F2, the reduced neutral current cross section, is the way that we get, or the main information that we get on the gluon density in the proton. And that's because the Q squared evolution is driven, certainly at low X, primarily by this splitting that I've illustrated here. Gluon goes to QQ bar. And in the lowest order, simplest level approximation, there's this nice approximation from Pritz, which basically says that the gluon at 2x is basically the logarithmic q squared derivative of the cross section at x. So you can see the slope, the logarithmic slope in q squared is exactly how you get the gluon. And there is a reasonable lever arm in the HERA data, as you can see, down to about x of 10 to the minus 3, which is what gets you to the sorts of plots that Katarzyna showed of the parton densities. So let me go to the parton densities in a bit more detail, just to give the overlap. So there they are, up and down valence quarks at high X, peaking a little bit below a third, but roughly speaking what you'd expect. And then a C quark density and a gluon quark density, which really fly off as X gets small. And Rolf emphasized this by showing them on the same scale. The typical sort of scale that's used in HERA presentations is to downscale these by a factor of 20, just to get them on the same picture at a scale of 10 GeV squared. So I'm going to be mainly interested in this gluon density here, which is one of the main targets for EIC and is the origin of the interest in diffraction at HERA. So you can see the sort of precision. The right-hand side is the projection of the uncertainties on the left-hand plot. So the sort of precision that you get on the gluon density is sub 2% from HERA data over that quite wide range between x of about 10 to the minus 3 and 10 to the minus 1. But the thing I'm really interested in from the diffractive point of view is this fast rise as X gets smaller. It appears to be non-sustainable. The speed at which this rises changes with Q squared, but at any perturbative sort of Q squared, as you go to lower and lower X, you start to worry about whether that gluon can continue in that sort of way. And there are different solutions to how the gluon might stop rising. There are BFK or resummations, as Katarzyna talked about, but probably the one that excites people most is the idea of a saturation phenomenon where things like recombinations maybe take place, two gluons recombining back into a single gluon. So does that gluon saturate? And emerged and encapsulated in all of that are some of the main targets for EIC physics and their emergent phenomena, as Rolf said, things like confinement, mass, spin, but I would also say diffraction and the sort of nonlinear evolution that we talk about for saturation. So why diffraction then? Well, here's three reasons why diffraction is a good way to look at this sort of thing. And the first one focuses on this diagram at the top here, where the simplest way to make a proton stay intact in a collision is to exchange two gluons. It could be quarks as well. Turns out gluons are better just because there's more of them. Two gluons with equal and opposite color combinations. So that interpretation of diffraction in terms of two gluon exchange basically squares your sensitivity to the gluon when you look at diffractive or exclusive channels like this one compared with the inclusive. So that's one good reason. The other good reason is that, of course, if you're picking out more than one parton from the croton at the same time, you can look at correlations between the partons. And embedded in that is a lot of the story about 3D imaging that, that Rolf emphasized very nicely in his talk. And the third reason is, again, following on from that, and this time much more to do with saturation, that there is another variable, kinematic variable. It's illustrated on the bottom diagram, which is actually very similar to the top one, but I've just illustrated the two gluons by this these pair of lines here, that the momentum transfer squared at the proton vertex, T, is conjugate to impact parameter. So by impact parameter, I mean what the relative distance is from the center of the proton to the where the probe comes in. So the bigger the impact parameter, the smaller T is, and vice versa. So by scanning this T variable, you can effectively scan the transverse dimension in the target. And for example, if there's a dense area in the middle, then you might be able to see that in particular regions. So that's just some of the reasons why diffraction is an interesting thing to do. What about HERA then? Well, this has already been introduced at least once, so I won't go through it all again. We had four experiments. The ones that I'll talk entirely about actually are the colliding beam ones, H1 and Zeus. The center of mass energy was great. It was 300 GeV from electron-proton collisions with these energies. The luminosities weren't great. So over the entire lifetime of the experiments, we collected half an inverse femtobarn each. And just to put that in context, in EIC studies, we talk about tens, hundreds of inverse femtobarns all the time. So that's the collider that we talk about. I just summed up, actually this slide's a few years old, but at the time when I summed it up, I don't think it's changed much. This was just an indication of the number of publications that have been published by H1 on diffraction, just to emphasize that it was really a very major part of the physics program there. So inclusive cross sections, so basically any case in which the proton stays intact, diffractive final states, so looking into whatever this system in the middle of the diagram here is, looking for jets, charm and so on. Quasi-elastic cross sections where we just, this state in the middle is just a single vector meson, and actually total, looking at the total cross section in the photo production limit where Q squared tends to zero as well. So altogether, you know, more than 60 papers per collaboration on these sorts of topics. Right, so the basic way of looking at this, for a lot of people at least, is to factorize out the electron. So if you take out the electron photon vertex, then what you're left with is a diffractive collision between a photon and a proton. And it turns out that HERA, actually I think the same will be true for EIC, have favorable kinematics to look at whatever this photon dissociates into. So if you think about it as photon, proton goes to some system X, which is the photon dissociating. This system Y most of the time is just a proton, and we're interested in looking at that X system. And the fact that we're looking at photons is quite powerful because the photons can be real, Q squared tends to zero, in which case you're really looking at a soft collision between a photon and a proton, or they can be highly virtual. And you can scan that transition from low to high Q squared in diffractive processes, just as you saw in the last talk, you can in inclusive. Okay, so that's the sort of picture we're going to be looking at. So let me start with exclusive vector meson production. So this is cases where this system X is just a single particle, single vector meson. And just to show you the sorts of experimental situations that we're looking at. So this is photo production of Jabe size. So the electron goes on down the beam pipe. We have a photon proton interaction. The proton goes off down the beam pipe, and all you see in the detector is the relics of a single vector meson, a Jabe size. which in these beautiful event displays is decaying to a pair of muons. And there's a difference between the top and the bottom event displays, apart from the overall color scheme. And that is that the muons are going in one direction in the top and in the other direction in the bottom. And actually that direction basically tells you about the photon-proton center of mass energy, how much of the electron's energy the photon had. So the top event is a high W event. So W is the photon-proton center of mass energy. So the J psi is going forward. And if the photon has less energy, so W is smaller, the muons go very backward. But they're beautifully clean events, and that's part of the attraction. So how do we describe these things in terms of partons? Well, let me skip to a dipole model sort of way of thinking about these things, which is going to come back again and again, I would imagine, this week. So I won't go into the full details, but just to orient you. The picture is that the photon dissociates into a QQ bar pair. So photon fluctuates into a QQ bar dipole, so to say. Then that dipole somehow interacts with the proton. That's what's in the gray box there, in a way that keeps the dipole intact afterwards, and then reforms into a vector meson. So that's one way of picturing this sort of process. So there's a three-step factorization in this diagram. Firstly, the photon fluctuating into the dipole. Well, that photon wave function is basically known. We understand QED. The recombination at the right-hand side is not so well known, because we need to know the vector meson wave function very accurately, so that does limit the theoretical precision to some extent. But the really interesting physics is contained in the gray box there. So that's the dipole proton interaction, and this slide just shows a couple of examples of how you might characterize that gray box. So leading order description with two gluons. It's probably not very realistic, but it's relatively is one of the easier things to code up. On the right hand side, this is a BFKL resummed one over log one over X ladder. So all sorts of different ideas about what lies in that dipole proton interaction, some phenomenological, some based more deeply on QCD calculations. So there'll be lots about that in the later talks, but that's just to introduce you to the language a little bit. One question in all of this is, what's the relative scale at which to try to describe the physics? Is it just Q squared? Well, it turns out no, actually, and I'll say a bit more about that in a minute. The vector meson mass plays a role as well. So this is just one example scale that's been chosen that works quite well, Q squared plus M squared over 4. So just to say. Okay, so let me get to some data in one more slide. So vector mesons beautifully illustrate the transition between the soft and the hard regimes. And as Barbara pointed out in the chat in between, it's not a phase transition sort of transition, but there is a transition from a region in which partons are good degrees of freedom and a region where they're less good. And I think vector mesons show that really nicely. The phenomenology of this is basically coming from energy dependencies, which are power law-like. So this equation here, d sigma dt, is the cross section for the vector meson production. W naught is just a scale. So it goes like W squared to a power, which has got this alpha of T in it, times E, an exponential of E to the BT. So I should explain and unpack this a little bit. If I was giving a series of lectures, there'd be a whole lecture on this alpha of T. This is regi phenomenology. This is stuff that predates QCD in a way that describes energy dependencies of hadronic processes in terms of so-called Pomerons. But this alpha of T is what's known as the effective Pomeron trajectory. It's just something that depends very slowly on T, but gives you a power law dependence. So at T of zero, it's just a number which is slightly bigger than one. It tells you that the cross section grows at W squared to a number slightly bigger than one. So slightly slow growth with energy, changes slowly with T. The e to the bt is an empirically motivated part of the function. It's essentially the Fourier transform of the spatial distribution of the interaction. So it tells you how big the interaction region is. It's, as I mentioned earlier, b is t is conjugate to the impact parameter. So in this decomposition in terms of dipoles, it gets a contribution from the dipole size, gets a contribution from the proton size. But then as the proton, and of course the virtual photon size is usually ignorable, as the proton, as the dipole size tends to zero, actually it measures the size of the proton. I'll come back to that in a moment. So that's a sort of soft physics description. If you start, if you didn't know about QCD, you could write that down straight away. So a signature of a hard behavior where you can start to really apply perturbative QCD techniques is a breakdown of this sort of description. And the sort of classic signatures are that this alpha of zero, 1.08, increases, or and that the B slope, the speed with which this thing falls, the slope falls exponentially with T, also decreases. So let's get to some data then. So this nice plot, famous plot, shows you what happens in photo production of vector mesons. So it's all Q squared of zero. And all that's been shown here is the photon-proton center of mass energy dependence of, ignore the total cross-section at the top for a moment, of lots of different vector meson species. So it's gamma P goes to rho P at the top, gamma P goes to epsilon P at the bottom. And what you see in this plot is that the slope, the energy dependence, gets stronger as you go down the plot from lighter to heavier vector mesons. And if you characterize that in terms of a W to the delta, you can relate delta to this alpha of T that I mentioned a moment ago. Basically, you can see something that's totally consistent with what happens in proton-proton physics, soft physics for the rho, to something very different in the Jabe-Psi case. So this slope for the Jabe-Psi gives you a Pomeroy intercept of about 1.2. So you learn straight away that the presence of the charm, or even more so the beauty mass, implies that perturbative implies that the soft physics description is breaking down, and that perturbative QCD effects are already present at Q squared of zero for these heavy mass particles. You can turn the Q squared handle instead of the mass handle. And what happens there is if you take the Jabe Psi, actually you don't see very much change with Q squared. The point being that that Jabe Psi exclusive production is already a hard process at Q squared of zero, so it doesn't get much harder by winding Q squared up. On the other hand, the light vector mesons are sensitive to Q squared. So these are two plots from rho electro production here. So you've got lines here at different Q squared. And okay, I've not put all the fits there are to a W to a power. I've not put them on this slide. I think they're on the next one. But that power delta gets larger as you go up in Q squared. And similarly on the right hand side, the e to the bt bit, which tells you about the impact parameter distribution, that also, these slopes also flatten as you change Q squared. So that's an indication that the hard effects turn on as you increase Q squared. Actually, this stuff gets quite complicated because there are both longitudinal and transverse contributions to vector meson production, and they have slightly different Q squared dependencies. But there are no scales added on these slides. What you also can see if you just scan down as you go up in Q squared is that there's a strong decrease with Q squared, actually stronger than you see with the classic sort of 1/(q^4) dependence that you expect for the inclusive cross section. These things fall like stronger powers than that. And that's an indication that these are so-called higher twist processes, as you would expect for a two gluon exchange. Okay. So one slide to show you the other characterizations of the vector meson production in HERA. So these are just overall data shown for lots of different species. So the rho, phi, Jabe psi are all combined in one plot here using this effective scale Q squared plus M squared, actually divided by 4. So the Pomeroy intercept, the thing that describes the energy dependence, where you can see that grow with this overall scale in a way that could be consistent with being the same for all of the different vector meson species as you go up in mu squared. The T slope is on the bottom here. This is again shown for all the different species of vector meson. The interesting thing about that is that yes, it decreases as this Q squared plus M squared goes up, but it kind of, especially when you look at this epsilon point at high values of the scale, there's evidence that it stops falling. And that's just consistent with the proton size So actually the t-slope seems to saturate at a B of about 4 to 5. And if you do some more detailed analysis of this, you find it's about, corresponds to about 0.6 Fermi. Whereas you sort of, your intuitive belief of the size of a proton is more like 1 Fermi. So the suggestion is that the gluon content of the proton is wrapped up in a slightly smaller size overall than is typically true of the electromagnetic size. So that's a sort of overall characterization. Before I go away from vector mesons, I wanted to focus a bit more on this JPSI photo production diagram. So why is it interesting? Well, I already mentioned that it's got this clean signature, the JPSI just decaying to muons. The effective scale, if you do take something like Q squared plus M squared over 4, it's just nice, 3 GeV squared, so it's just in the perturbative regime, but only just in the perturbative regime, so maybe it gives you the maximum reach towards lowest X, if you can fix your kinematic plane while still being perturbative. So it's a possible, it's a nice place to go and look, for example, for a classic saturation signature. And how would you see saturation? Well, the energy dependence would presumably flatten as you get to higher and higher energies, or equivalently lower and lower X. And maybe it would do that in a manner which depends on T, impact parameter, or the size of the nuclear target, so EA versus EP. So these are nice places to look. It's not all roses. There are some complications. I already mentioned the vector meson wave function. There is also, you know, a less well-developed theory of this sort of thing than there is of collinear physics. So basically, there's the convergence of the series, if you try and do collinear calculations, is not great. NLO versus LO is not converging well. So that's one other issue. Here's some data from HERA. So the plot on the top left I chose because it illustrates the sensitivity to different PDF sets. So this is just one model. You can see the curves are proton structure calculation, are PDF sets. Sorry, the same calculation based on different PDF sets from MRT and so on. So you can see that they diverge a bit in a way that the data look to be sensitive to, actually. So, you know, if you don't include the theoretical errors, then this process totally tells you about the gluon density in a way that's probably better than inclusive physics. The trouble is that the theoretical errors are large. So then there's just other plots on here. This one on the bottom right shows the cross section divided by the fit, and so basically illustrates the same thing again, that the sensitivity is large. So if you go looking for saturation, then you might look for this energy dependence flattening off at high W, and you can see that there's no evidence for that in the HERA data that are shown on here. Actually, this is an area where the LHC has taken us further forward. So there's so-called ultra-peripheral collisions at the LHC. The diagram is shown in the top right here. So this is photon-proton, where the photon emerges from proton, or even better, a heavy ion, because this coupling here is charge squared weighted. So you make a photo production process essentially out of a heavy ion or a PA process at the LHC. And the nice thing about that is the NH, you can benefit from the LHC energy, which takes you to energies or higher energies or lower X values than HERA. So HERA plots from LHCB, CMS and ALICE, I think those three plots respectively, all of which have got JPSI photo production data extending to beyond the TeV. People have analyzed this in lots of different ways. Again, it distinguishes nicely between different models, but if you want to really pin down parton densities, you have the same problem of convergence of perturbative series. And if you want to go and look for saturation, the conclusion generally out of this is that, again, there's still no evidence for the fact that this rise with increasing W in any way flattens. That's not the end of the story. I think it's possible that more subtle signatures could exist once you go to T dependencies, and also once you look at the ratio of electron ion to electron proton. And those are certainly topics for the EIC as well as for LHC. I shouldn't move away from exclusive processes in DIS without mentioning deeply virtual Compton scattering, DVCS. So that's the exclusive production of a photon in a high Q squared process, diagrams like the one on the bottom right here. And I'm not going to talk much about that, not in the HERA context anyway, the reason being that HERA didn't manage to study it very well, partly because of that extra coupling to a photon there. That decreases the cross-section relative to a vector meson production, and the HERA luminosity limitations meant that this process came late into the HERA story and was always luminosity limited. HERA, of course, also didn't have polarized proton beams, and looking at this process as a function of proton polarization is also a very powerful thing to do. But when we go to EIC physics, I think this will be an absolutely classic, probably most important process of all, in addition to the meson, diffractive meson production, but in terms of understanding the transverse structure, the 3D structure of the proton via generalized parton densities. No doubt more to come in this summer school about that. But that's just a picture there that shows you what HERA managed to do in the end. There are DVCS data, but it's rather limited. Right, so let me move on from exclusive processes to inclusive processes. So inclusive diffraction in deep inelastic scattering. And I'm looking at event displays like this one on the bottom left now. So this is EP goes to E anything P. And the striking thing about this diagram, this event display, particularly if you're used to looking at other event displays from HERA, is that there's absolutely nothing in the calorimeter in the forward direction. So that indicates that the proton's gone off down the beam pipe, not color connected to the rest of the hadronic final state that you see in the central detector there. So there's no color string here, so there's no particle production in the forward direction. So the interpretation of this sort of event was very exciting early in the HERA story. And I think, as Rolf already mentioned, there's about 10% of deep inelastic scattering events that are like this. So it's not an esoteric corner, it's really a mainstream part of DIS. So this diagram in the top here illustrates the sort of process I'm talking about. So the proton stays intact. And I think I have a slide that defines these variables. No, excuse me. Okay, so Q squared obviously is the photon virtuality. X breaks down into two. So typically this is broken down into X pomeron, which is the fraction of the proton's momentum carried by the exchange, and beta, which is the fraction of the exchange momentum carried by the quark that couples to the photon. So you get two new kinematic variables in addition to T, but you always bear in mind that beta times X pomeron is just X, same thing. These things got studied in two different ways at HERA, distinguished on this slide. One, I've already sort of indicated that you can select the events by looking for a lack of energy in the forward part of the calorimeter. That's called so-called large rapidity gap method of selection. And on the left-hand side is the way that I think will be much more the case at future colliders, which is that you actually tag the intact proton as it goes down the beam pipe. So this is a blow up here of H1 on the right hand side and all of the different instrumentation that's out there in the forward direction. And you can see right up to 200 meters downstream, there is an instrumentation. And this is a Roman pot, which is placed into the beam pipe, vacuum sealed insertion, which houses sensitive detectors, which can tag protons scattered through tiny, tiny angles, milliradians. So at HERA, this large rapidity gap method was the main workhorse. I think that was partly due to technologies that were available at the time. There were leading proton spectrometers, but I think by the time we get to EIC, it's much more likely that the sort of process on the right, on the left, will be used, just because tagging the proton is so much more direct. Here, just for fun, is a picture of some example Roman pots at HERA. So we struggled a long time to get these going, just to illustrate. This is 200 meters downstream, and there are insertions into the beam pipe for the so-called very forward proton spectrometer. That sort of developed during the course of HERA. If you look at the LHC, I think the totem experiment at one point had 14 different Roman pots, not necessarily inserted all at the same time, but that just gives you an indication of how much more mainstream this sort of method of tagging diffraction has become. And as Janusz mentioned, we work on that very much in Atlas as well. Ah, okay, here's the kinematic variable slide. Sorry, it's in the wrong place, but I think we already went through what Xpomeran and Beta are. Right, so let's break this process down then. So the diagram in the top right sort of illustrates the sort of factorizations that we're looking for. And if you've got a process which in principle can depend on four variables, being able to factorize out dependencies on those different variables is very important. Turns out that works, and it works in an intuitive way as well. So this diagram looks like the emission, I use that very loosely, of a Pomeran or some other color singlet exchange from the proton, factorized from the interaction of that object which gets exchanged with the electron or the photon. And there's just a couple of plots here which illustrate that the dependence on X Pomeran and T doesn't change as you go with Q squared. So the X Pomeran dependence is again parameterized through the effective Pomeran intercept, has no dependence on Q squared, and the T dependence is coming from the slope. Again, as far as we can see, that doesn't depend on Q squared. So we can really think about this as deep inelastic scattering off whatever this exchanged object is. Now, one of the interesting things is the actual value of this alpha Pomeran variable. We mentioned that in J-Psi photo production, for example, it's 1.2. In the inclusive DIS data that we're looking at here, it's more like 1.1. So it's entirely consistent with what you see in soft proton-proton physics. The B slope is a bit harder than that. But I think, you know, all of this picture ends up with you thinking that a large part of what's done in diffractive DIS is deep inelastic scattering from an object which is very like a soft Pomeran being exchanged from a proton. So think about a cloud of color singlet connected gluons or so on, quarks, if it's a subleading exchange around the proton that you're scattering off. It's probably not a bad picture. So what about this actual scattering of the electron from this color singlet exchange? Well, there was a lot of work at HERA on that. So if I now fix X Pomeran and T, actually it's usually integrated over T and fixed in X Pomeran. So the plot on the left-hand side, for example, is where the proton has lost 1% of its energy. That's X Pomeran. And then you can make a plot that looks very similar to the one that I showed in the first slide and that Katarzyna had for inclusive DIS. It just looks like the Q squared dependence at fixed beta here, but that's the equivalent of X for the proton. And you can see the dependencies very nicely. And you can see that it scales with Q squared roughly, actually rises slowly. Similar sort of plots on the right-hand side, just for completeness, to show that this is done in the HERA data at lots of different X Pomeran values. So there's about 10% of the total cross-section. The fact that this has the same sort of Q squared dependence as the inclusive cross-section, rather than the very different one that vector mesons has, indicates that this is a so-called leading twist process. It's not Q squared suppressed. And just as in the inclusive case, the inclusive data dependence on beta and Q squared, the diffractive data dependence on beta and Q squared tells us about the structure of this exchange. Similar sort of equations to the ones that Katarzyna showed. So the quark distribution is basically measured by the cross section, and the gluon distribution comes from the change of the cross section with log Q squared, the logarithmic Q squared derivatives. So all of that gets fed into DGLAT-based QCD fits, very similarly to the inclusive case, and you end up with a picture of the quark and gluon structure of the diffractive exchange, the Pomeran in some language. This is what it looks like. Now it's shown here at different, it's quarks on the left and gluons on the right, shown here from an H1 example fit of lots of different Q squared values. Well, the change with Q squared isn't big, so let's just look at one fixed Q squared, like 8.5, for example. Two striking things. One is that if you look at the absolute scale of these things, gluons are much bigger than quarks. And the other one is that these distributions extend all the way up to X. Sorry, there's so many variables, but this Z is basically the same as beta. And the distribution extends all the way to the highest Z values. So large momentum fractions, mostly gluons, is what's been struck by that quark there. So that's diffractive parton densities. It is worth noting in passing that actually these fits break down at Q squared of about 5 or so. So the lowest Q squared region isn't described, which still leaves room for all sorts of interesting effects for EIC and non-factorizing effects. What's the point in doing this? Well, the point in doing this is that you should then be able to take your diffractive parton densities and use them to predict other cross-sections, charm, jets, things like that, in the same way as people do for inclusive scattering. And here's just a couple of examples of how well that works in diffractive DIS. So we're now looking at diagrams like this, boson-gluon fusion, or photon-gluon fusion, they're often called. So you produce either charm or a jet or something like that. And there's just a couple of examples of measurements of these processes in diffractive DIS. Top right here is D-star production, so charm quark production. Bottom left here is jet production, both in diffractive cases, and they've been predicted by the PDFs, the diffractive PDFs that have been extracted from inclusive DIS data. And you can see the agreement is very good. That's universally seen in all studies of diffractive DIS final states at HERA. So there's a remarkable success in the internal consistency of this partonic picture of inclusive diffraction. You might ask, what about dipole models when you come to diffractive DIS? They're certainly obtained and they've been done by many groups. Of course, that might also be an opportunity when you go below this Q squared 5 region where the diffractive PDF fits to seem to start to break down. There is a complication, which is that just taking QQ bar final states like the top diagram, top right diagram there, isn't sufficient. You need to take into account QQ bar dipoles consisting of a QQ bar and a gluon, so an octet-octet dipole as well, in order to describe low X data. So I won't say any more about this, except that this approach does still exist and there are very much people still working on applying dipoles to inclusive diffractive DIS. Right, quickly before I move away from the inclusive diffraction then. In inclusive DIS, you know, you get the proton PDFs from HERA, you go and use them and apply them at the LHC in order to predict cross sections for jets, for example, and it all works beautifully. Can you do that in diffraction? Well, unfortunately not. When you try and predict proton-proton diffraction starting from diffractive DIS, things fail quite catastrophically, actually, nicely illustrated in this plot in the top right. So the data with the yellow band around it here are diffractive dijet data from CDF at the Tevatron. The curves at the top there are some predictions based on diffractive PDFs from HERA. And the difference is something like an order of magnitude. So it goes wrong by order, or pretty much an order of magnitude. That's disappointing, but it's not surprising. And the reason it's not surprising is because of this proton remnant here, which is present in proton-proton or proton-antiproton, but it's not present in EP. And the explanation is that there's rescattering effects. Essentially, diagrams like this get spoiled by final state interactions or initial state interactions involving this remnant. And that leads to this so-called rapidity gap survival probability, which is of the order of 0.1 here. The same sorts of effects are seen at the LHC. How do you understand rapidity gap survival probabilities? You know, they're things that you can calculate phenomenologically, but where can you test them? Well, it turns out you can go to photo production in lepton-hadron scattering to try and do that, because there's a nice control experiment there in the sense that photo productions breaks down into cases where the photon interacts as a whole, so-called direct photon interactions, where there's no remnant and you'd expect a perfect survival probability, and cases where the photon actually interacts in a resolved way. So the photon has its own effective internal structure, which basically starts from its QQ bar splitting. And there can be remnants around in this resolved photo production case, which are very like the proton-proton cases. So you might expect, if you can go to X gamma, so fraction of the photon interacting in the process, less than 1, to see a rapidity gap survival probability that's much less than 1 as well. That was a long story at HERA, and I think it's nicely summarized in this slide, really, which is the consistent with previous H1 data and marginally consistent with ZEUS. but I think it's basically amounts to the same story in the end. There is a suppression when you look at diffraction in photo production compared with DIS. So the data over there's a double ratio here, which is data over theory, photo production divided by DIS. So if there was no gap survival probability, this would be one. Any inadequacies in the theory might cancel in taking the double ratio. But the bottom line is that in photo production, you see a suppression of about 50%. In DIS, this is something which gives you a ratio of around about one. So you do seem to see these rescattering effects in photo production. They're much smaller in the Zeus data, if present at all. But there is another mystery as well, because this expected dependence on X gamma doesn't seem to be there, or at least we haven't found it there yet. So there are still some mysteries to be understood in diffractive photo production, and it's a topic that's very much alive at EIC as well. Right, so for the last couple of minutes, I just want to talk a little bit about how all of this stuff might move forward into the electron ion collider era. Now, it's early days, but there have been a few studies, and maybe I can give you at least a flavour. So there were studies in the early EIC work, which were called day one at the EIC. Now, day one was probably a bit optimistic, but the idea here was to find processes which you can do with a relative, with a small amount of luminosity, this fraction of what EIC will collect in a year. And one of the earliest things that you might want to study is the ratio of diffraction to inclusive DIS. Motivated a bit by this plot on top here, this is a famous plot from Zeus, which said, goodness me, this ratio is flat. It's integrated over the diffractive T dependence and so on. But, you know, you can see very visually there that there's no strong dependence on the center of mass energy in the photon-proton system. So that was taken as evidence for saturation, still is. Question is, what would EIC see? And there's just one nice study from this EIC day one simulations, which basically confirms that this sort of plot could be not only used to establish whether saturation's there, but to distinguish it from nuclear shadowing. So if you've got electron gold and electron proton, for example, you might see the ratio of electron gold to electron proton diffraction over total going actually in different directions, depending on whether you've got shadowing or saturation. So that's something which might be established really very quickly if you've got small amounts of data for EP and electron and a heavy ion. Sticking with sticking with early data, but this time going to exclusive diffraction. A very nice process to study would be this one in the top right. So this is photon heavy iron goes to vector meson heavy iron. So that process, when it happens fully coherently, is a very interesting process for reasons I'll get to in a minute. The background to it is distinguishing it from the plot on the bottom there, which is still a diffractive process, but one in which the ion dissociates into lots of other things. So there are ways of telling the difference, and it's basically to do with tagging these extra fragments you get here, for example, in a 0-degree calorimeter. But assuming you can get to this coherent process, and the plot in the bottom left here just shows you the sort of challenge you've got in suppressing the incoherent to get to the coherent, which has got this nice characteristic, almost diffractive pattern shape. For the JAPE side, if you can get there, there are big rewards. So the saturation effects, this is just total JAPE side production cross section as a function of center of mass energy, and this is in the BSAT model, just one example of a dipole model that predicts these sorts of things, showing you how the cross section drops very heavily as you go to heavier ions compared with if you expect it to scale with A. So this is a big suppression in heavy ions, which you might want to go and look for. The early studies in EIC data suggested that actually the phi might be an even better tool to study this with than the JAPE psi. Just shows you the difference between no saturation and saturation effects in the ratio of this process up here to the EP process. So massive effect in the phi. But still some in the JAPE psi. So that's another thing to look out for and maybe study early on in EIC physics. What about inclusive diffraction? So here's the kinematic plane in Q squared and X for inclusive diffraction, which shows the HERA data, they're the points in there, data that you might get from a higher energy EP collider at the LHC at the top, that's LHEC and so on. But the EIC data is in this purple region here. And the striking thing about this compared with what Katashena showed, for example, is that this corner here at high X and low Q squared has got no previous data in it. And that's just because there have not been previous detailed studies of diffraction in previous experiments. So that's a region that the EIC can definitely fill in. And I think it will be probably, if anything, more powerful in diffraction than in inclusive studies. So that's even more interesting because it's exactly a region where we don't really understand what's going on very well in diffractive structure. So these are just two different models of the gluon density at high momentum fractions, just the region this is sensitive to. So some studies were done by that already. I think I saw Wojtek Smolinski online earlier. This is his work. And some in the context of EIC, where we expect the Roman pots, the proton taggers to be, these are just some plots that look at the acceptance and as a function of T, and again, so many variables, but something really closely related to the Ex-Pomeroy variable I introduced earlier. But it just shows you, firstly, that there's good coverage at different centre of mass energies at EIC in this region where XL is large, or currently Ex-Pomeroy is small, which would be diffractive, dominated by the diffractive or Pomeroy exchange. So you can see those regions, but there's also coverage then to much, much lower XLs or higher X-Pomerons, where you get interested in the exchange of other particles here, things that are related to mesons, for example, often called subleaning region exchanges. So there's an opportunity to study those in EIC physics. This is just one plot that shows you the sorts of regions which are beyond the acceptance of HERA that we can study for diffractive DIS in the EIC case. The green line shows you the size of this subleading exchange contribution in some models based on HERA data, and you can see it's really dominant in these high XI regions. So that would be one thing to study. Let me finish with a more ambitious thing, but Katarzyna and others, even in the chat, mentioned the power of EIC to look at the longitudinal structure function, because multiple different centre of mass energies are proposed. And that's equally true in diffraction. And the nice thing about the longitudinal structure function is that its lowest order is directly proportional to the gluon density. So it's really sensitive, again, to the gluon. And the way to get at it is to measure the same, in an inclusive case, XQ squared, but in diffraction, Xi, T, Ex-Pomeroy T, beta, keep all of the kinematic variables the same and look at the center of mass energy dependence. And through these sorts of plots, that then gets you to an FL measurement, which looks very promising on the basis of some of the early studies. And I think would be a nice way of getting at the gluon density and diffraction and maybe beyond. Okay, I guess I'm running out of time, but just to say, obviously, inclusive diffraction is also something you want to study in electron nucleus at the EIC. So the process is electron gold, for example, goes to electron X times gold. There are no good predictions of this sort of thing. I hope I don't insult anybody by saying that, but you know, the predictions are really very different. These are just two different plots that show the same thing in related models from Frankfurt, Goosey and Strickman. So two different models already looking different. So there are simulations there of the sort of measurements that we could do, but they will be very powerful as well. Right, so I'm finished. Quick summary is that HERA, I think, revolutionized our understanding of diffraction in QCD. In the exclusive vector meson case, we saw the way that hard scales turn on. And in the hard vector meson production case, there in principle is a good sensitivity to the gluon density and to equivalently to saturation as well as to imaging. In the inclusive process, we learned that you can do deep inelastic scattering off something very similar to a soft color singlet Pomeroy and work out what its structure is, and that structure looks very gluon dominated, and gluons carrying large fractions of the momentum. So EIC, of course, will therefore take us further with all of these things and many more. It will have improved beamline instrumentation because Roman pots have got better. It'll have much larger luminosity than HERA. It'll have electron heavy ion collisions, which HERA didn't do, and it will have polarization of the target, which HERA didn't do as well. So bright prospect ahead, and I'm sure you'll hear much more in the coming talks. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. Are there any questions or comments? Actually, I have one. In this exclusive diffraction, diffractive processes, where the EIC detectors aim at, of course, this was very much, very much stressed by COSE and company. The real exclusivity also in the ion direction.
Mm-hmm. Janice needs to answer his phone.
Actually, there is, in 5 minutes, there is forward, far forward detectors meeting for the EIC.
Yeah.
That's the alarm clock. Okay. Are there more questions or comments? If not, thanks a lot, Paul, okay, for your lecture.